Wireshark is an amazing tool used for capturing and analyzing packets. But what do you do if you don't have access to Wireshark? Maybe you're in an environment that doesn't allow it because of permissions, or you lack the internet access needed to do the installation. Or if you want to be discreet on a pen test and bring in the minimal set of tools, or perhaps you're working on a headless instance via a shell found in cloud computing and other remote data center environments. In this video, I'm going to show you several other ways to do packet collection, two for Windows and one for Linux and macOS. And I'm going to show you a third-party tool that you can bring in and do captures in almost any environment. For Windows, the first is Packet Monitor, or pktmon.exe. This command can be ran in PowerShell, and you do need to run it as an administrator. Now, this tool is going to be available on Windows 10 onward and in Windows Server 2019 and above. Type in Packet Mon list, and I can see I've got two adapters, so I'm now going to use that information to start my capture. Pktmon start-c tells it to start capturing. The dash-dash comps is short for component one, the primary NIC on my Azure virtual machine. The dash F is the file name, and the dash M is multi-file. So out of the box, PacketMon will log in a file until the file hits the max file size. When it writes that 513th megabyte, you're gonna overwrite the files. I just get in the habit of using multi-file, so that way it'll, for every 512 megabytes, it's gonna make a new file. I'm gonna go ahead and generate some traffic now. So let's go ahead and stop it. And I see that I have an ETL file. For now, we just want the PCAP. So I type in packetmon pcapng. I give it the name of the file, and it's going to go ahead and just pull out just the PCAP from the ETL and log it for me. But what if you're on an older version of Windows, maybe Windows XP, some kind of OT or factory environment? Well, that's where the second tool comes in. The second tool is Network Shell, or NetSH, available on Windows versions all the way back to Windows XP and Windows Server 2008. Release 2 and above. This tool also does require admin, so the first thing I need to do is take a look at my interfaces. The NetSH trace start capture equals yes starts the actual capture. Your trace file is the output. Report equals no, which is going to save us a little bit of time at the end of this. Capture interface equals 4 is targeting my interface that I'm collecting on. The max size equals 0 and file mode equals single. That tells it to log in a single file, otherwise it will do circular patterns again. And the perf merge equals no is to keep the NetSH consolidation phase as short as possible. So I'm going to go out and generate a little bit more traffic. And then I'm going to go and stop the file. So right now NetSH is assembling the ETL file. I found this process to be much, much slower. Okay, so it's finished. I have our ETL file here, and now we've got to convert it. And you might be thinking, okay, can I use PacketMon's ETL to PCAPNG to convert? And actually, you can't. It won't recognize it. So there's another tool you need. It's called ETL to PCAPNG. You can get it from Microsoft's GitHub page. So this is a Microsoft ETL to PCAPNG. You can download the exe right here. It's signed binary. You won't have any problems with it. And now I'm ready to do a conversion. So now I have my PCAPNG file. I'm ready for some analysis. If you don't have access to Wireshark and you're living off the land with these tools, but you can get to the internet, you can analyze the files easily with Teleseer. And I put both of these network captures into Teleseer to take a look at them. Got PacketMon capture on the left, got the NetSH capture on the right. They're both in their own projects. And I've opened them up in Teleseer in a timeline only mode to clearly see all the protocols. Got the various websites I was interacting and some that I didn't realize I was interacting with. I could see I've got my encrypted traffic around my SSH and RDP. And I picked up my remote desktop connection that I was using to connect to the Azure virtual machine itself. NetSH, pretty much the same thing.
But what if you are in a Linux or Mac OS environment? tcpdump is gonna be your go-to live off the land tool. The first thing I wanna do is get my interface. I wanna know what interface to collect on. So I'm gonna pick ETH0 and I'm gonna type in tcpdump, the name of the interface with the dash I option. And then I'm gonna do dash W and give it a file. So now it's running, it's listening. So I'm gonna jump into another window on the same machine and just start generating some traffic. I'm going to search down here for something that catches my eye. I'm going to grab this. I'm going to control C to stop my transfer. And I could see that it was a little over 1,000 packets collected. None were dropped, which is good. And I can see that I have my pc.pcap file. Now, how are we going to analyze this? This is a headless Linux environment. We don't have Wireshark. We can't get to Teleseer. So we've got to get the PCAP off this machine onto another machine with those tools. One option is to use a trick where you do a SSH tunnel and run the capture command through the tunnel, but store the results of tcpdump on the collection device itself. You're going to SSH into your target where you want to do the capture. In this case, it's analyst at the hostname. So this is my Linux machine and my Linux user. Then in quotes, I'm going to put the command I want to run on the target itself. So there's the sudo for that elevation. And then I'm going to add a timeout 60 in here. That's going to allow tcpdump to stop gracefully after 60 seconds. If you don't do that, I found that sometimes if you control C and interrupt the SSH tunnel, you actually prematurely cut tcpdump and it causes malformed packets and the capture is not going to be any good. So I add my interface. Now I'm going to add a filter, and the filter is basically saying don't collect when the packet is port 22 and this host. This host is the Windows machine that I'm collecting from. I don't want to collect my own traffic for the tunnel. And then this redirect says log this locally. I'm going to go ahead and start that. So it's running. Okay, so it finished right around 500 packets. And now if I look, I can see that I have here locally my capture file, tcpdump remote 3. So now this is ready for analysis either with Wireshark or Teleseer. Another option for collecting on Linux or macOS is to use Packet Streamer by DeepVents. Packet Streamer is a third-party tool. It's designed as a remote collection tool, so you can set up a sensor on one machine and you can send packets directly to a receiver running Packet Streamer on another machine. And it also has a lot of other features. It has security built in, so you can use keys. You can also log directly to an S3 bucket in AWS or GCP. Or you can even log to a Kafka server. Over on Cyberspatial Labs, we've actually forked the project. The reason we did that, we didn't make any modifications other than to set up a hub actions to build our binaries. I downloaded Packet Streamer -Windows-AMD64. I renamed it PacketStreamer.exe. I had to go into my Windows security settings and add an exception so that Windows Defender doesn't think it's a virus. And anyways, to get all that set, I am ready to execute it. And you'll need a configuration file. I've got address equals quad zero that tells my receiver to listen on its public facing address. This is the port that I want to listen on. And I'm gonna go ahead and log these two for now, packet stream. And now I'm ready to start the tool. So it's now waiting for sensors to connect to it. Now, the first time you run this on Windows, you might see a firewall pop up. You're gonna have to allow it to use that port that we designated. So I am over here on the sensor. This is a Linux VM on the same virtual private circuit as the Windows receiver. So they're on the same network. And I'm going to show you the config file on this. I'm telling it my server is at 10.1.0.6. That is my internal IP address for my Windows receiver running Packet Streamer that we just started. That's the port, and I'm telling it I want to collect all the PCAPs. So now I am ready to start my capture. I'm gonna go ahead and start it with privilege escalation. And now it is connected. You can see it connected to my receiver and it's sending traffic. Over here on the receiver side, I can see that the receiver's listening. The reason it's not sending a lot of traffic right now is there's not a lot going on this machine. In a separate window on my sensor, I'm going to ping yahoo.com, do some ICMP traffic. We'll do a little bit of SSH to GitHub, and we'll actually do something a little bit more aggressive here. So I'm going to ask the University of Utah mirror for Ubuntu to give me their ISO for Ubuntu 22. So this is going to generate a high volume traffic. If I pop back over on the synth, there's a lot of messages happening out, and I'm going to go ahead and stop this transfer. And over here, I'm going to stop the receiver. You can see that I have a pretty sizable capture here. So now we can go ahead and analyze this either with Wireshark or Teleseer. Okay, so I've opened up both the captures on Teleseer. So this first capture here, remote 3, this is where we used the tcpdump remotely and logged to Windows. I can see that I have some traffic here. I'm gonna go up to the network topology. I can see where my Linux machine was communicating with various servers. I can look at those servers. You recall we had some traffic at the end where we were hitting Cloudflare's DNS. I could see my connection to GitHub as well as Shodan IP. So that looks pretty interesting. And then over here, this is Packet Stream 2. You could see a lot of traffic here, a lot of volume here where we were downloading that ISO. What's really interesting is this SSH traffic. So when I look at my external host, I immediately see two
brute forcers, which were using basically SSH attacks to attack my VM as I was capturing on it. So that's really interesting. I can see that one of these machines is a known SSH brute forcer and the other one as well from Brazil. So these are machines that are probably scanning the internet and found my Azure VM and decided to log in. So this is why it's really important when you're doing security research to use virtual machines and don't use your own personal networks. Okay, I'm interested to hear what you think. What other techniques, methods, and tools have you worked with? Feel free to sound off in the comments section. We're always eager to hear about your own lessons learned, experiences, comments, feedback. And also check out the description of this video for links to our GitHub repo, that fork of Packet Streamer, and other notes about the commands shown in this video. Thanks for watching. If you like this content, feel free to give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to our channel, and until next time, take care.